Other announcements? Check behind me. All right. Well, can we take a quick moment to center ourselves, maybe pay attention to how our feet are on the floor. Maybe they are more comfortable crossed. Maybe we can relax some of that tension that we're feeling within our shoulders, within our neck. Let us take a few deep breaths in and let them out, and then I will open us in prayer. Gracious God, we gather as a people, longing to be connected, being driven by sensing a way that we are connected, that we are trying to find those intersectionalities that link us with our neighbor, that link us back to you, that we are always searching for this primordial source that draws all life back to itself. Lord, we come here on a Sunday where the focus of our talk is love, and we are just reminded that love, inclusive love, ever-expanding love, that is a message, that is a candle that needs to be lit every Sunday, not just once Sunday. Help us, God. Help us do that through our worship this morning. Help us do that as we affirm your presence with us. Help us do that as we affirm your presence that is always with us when we leave this space. Help us do that to the best of our abilities, using all our hearts and minds to worship you. Amen.
Justin, where did you put my paper?
Oh, I did take it.
You did take it.
I'll trade you.
Because too many people are wandering in the wilderness, because too many people are sitting in the valley of the shadow of death, because too many of our conversations are laced with conflict and rancor, we light candles.
Because people all over the world are suffering, and we're too often distracted to notice, we light candles.
Today we stop everything and light these candles, one for hope, one for peace, one for joy, and one for love.
May the light from these candles overwhelm the world.
May the light from these candles illuminate the valley of the shadow of death.
May the light and fire from these candles burn away everything that is preventing God's love from being born among us.
Friends, be not afraid. Even now, God's love is overwhelming the world on earth as it is in heaven.
Please join me in the responsive reading that is on the first page of your bulletin. You are favored ones of God. The Lord is with you. Be not afraid, for you have found favor with God.
Be not afraid, for you have found favor with God.
And together, we need not be afraid. We have found favor with God.
At this time now, I invite you to stand in body or spirit and join us in the singing of Carol 197, It Came Upon a Midnight Clear.
In this advent of expectation, draw us together in unity, that our praise and worship might echo in these walls and also through our lives. In this advent of expectation, draw us together in mission, that the hope within might be the song we sing and the melody of our lives. In this advent of expectation, draw us together in service, that the path we follow might lead us from the stable to a glimpse of eternity. Please join me now in the Lord's Prayer, and we'll begin with Our Coming Lord. Our coming Lord, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Sing my song. full house down here this morning. Amy's going to get the side seat. All right. It's wonderful to see you all this morning. I have a big question. I wonder, I'm curious to see, can you tell me one thing that you love? One thing. Jesus, that's a good church answer. That's really good. Jesus? That's always, it's a safe answer in church, no matter what anybody asks. They're like, what do you want? What do you have? What are we doing afterward? We're doing Jesus after church. That's right. It's a safe answer. Amen. What else? Candy. Love candy. Absolutely. Violet's been eating candy a lot lately. We found some old Halloween candy, so we've still been working our way through it. What is something else? Yes. What is it? Kittens. Love kittens. I like kittens a lot too. Kittens are soft. They feel nice. What else do we like?
My family.
Love your family. Yes, we love our family. Our family's really good. That's kind of what I'm going to get to today, too, the family. What else do we love? Anything else?
God.
We love God? That's right. That's another good one.
I think
you said dogs. Dogs or God. We're flipping around and we're talking the same thing. I like it. I like dogs, too. Dogs and God. That's a good thing. Good pair together. What else? What are they? Yes. Horses. Horses are nice, too. I sneeze around horses. I still love them, but I sneeze around them. Anything else? Yes. Love books. Lord knows I love them. I got a problem with books. I love them too much sometimes. That's great, though. It's wonderful. I think so. When we talk about love, we talk about the different things we love and how we love. You know, it's weird because we'll say stuff like, I love candy. But we all know we don't love candy the same way we love our family or our mommy and daddies or our grandparents. We talk about love in different ways. There's different types of love, but our language kind of confines it to that one word of love. But in other languages, such as the language we see in the Bible, they had different terms. They had agape. That was a Greek term that talked about a certain type of love towards God. There was terms in Hebrew, like hesed, talks about a certain type of love. And so I think it's always important that when we speak about love, we know that we don't love candy the same way we love mommy and daddy. And we don't love mom and daddy the same way. Well, we may love our kittens pretty hard, but we love our mom and dad and our grandparents. So I was thinking about, because I bought this thing about, love is always important. Love is the thing that triumphs everything. Love always wins. And I think that's important to remember today. It's important to remember that when things seem so crazy right now, when things seem like you have to wear a mask all the time, and we're asked to do certain things that just really make life uncomfortable, we do it because we love people, and we love each other, and we do it because God has called us to love each other, no matter what, no exceptions. God's love is inclusive. God's love is always there for us. Doesn't mean everything's going to be easy, but it means that we never have to go through stuff alone, and that's love. That's love when it's just family and everything else. That's all we have sometimes is our love for God and our love for each other. And so this day, on this Sunday of Advent, where we like the last of the four candles before we get to the Christ candle, it's that reminder that we are really called to be that spark, to be that light of love, and to go out and be with people and however they need. And sometimes that's not. Sometimes we bring a kit along to make them feel better, or sometimes that's bringing a book that they like to read, or sometimes that's bringing them some candy to make them feel better. We can do all kinds of things to show our love for each other. All right. Can we all pray this morning? All right. Gracious God, we are thankful that you have called us not only to love you, but to love each other. Help us be advocates. Help us be those people that really do proclaim that love has won, that what Christ has come and shown the world that it is something special and that it has drawn all people and all creation back to itself. Help us be examples of that. Help us find ways to love one another. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, go off and go downstairs. Good luck with Violet this morning. All right. You have a good time? I like how you do all that have horns on. I like that. At this time now, Patrice, looking back there. At this time now, Patrice, you can lead us through our prayers over here.
The verses, okay, the verses are all right. Yes, okay. So, instead of Philippians, Luke chapter 1, verses 39 through 56. And that could be pages 831 through 32. All right. All right. Are we all on the same page or at least in the same book now? Good. All right. I'll read the first verse. You'll come along with the second, and we'll do that until we get all the way to verses 56, and we'll read that one together. In those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord. And my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For the mighty God, one, has done great things for me, and holy is his name.
His mercy is flowing to generation.
He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. According to the promises he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and his descendants forever. And together, and Mary remained with her about 3 months and then returned to her home. The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God. All right, let's see if I can get this right. All right. Growing up where I did, we had a particular way of talking about people that we knew. We defined them in a sort of way that others might today describe those same relationship as being, well, these people are my friends or they are my acquaintances, but we never really used those terms growing up. For example, if someone asked you if you knew old man Beeson that lived at the end of the road, you might say, yeah, I know him, but I don't know him. You know, we might pass by each other and acknowledge each other's existence, but outside of that, I couldn't tell you anything about him. For others, though, the relationship was a bit closer, and we might say something like, yeah, I know Miss China. She's good people. We know her from when she used to work at the Goodwill or when she used to attend church and sing in the choir with one of our aunts, or we would just know her from other distinguishable places around town. As the circle gets even closer still, though, there were people that we were so close to that the term close friend or even family friend just didn't really work. My family had a lady like that. We had a lady like that who grew up near us, and her name was Miss Linda. Miss Linda wasn't kin, and what I mean when I say that is that she wasn't blood. She wasn't blood kin, but she was family. Family in the sense that she was invited to the big cookouts and get-togethers, but she was also invited to just stop by. You know, she would drop by on a Tuesday afternoon to help my grandmother hang and fold clothes, and that might lead to her being asked to pick up my mother from school in the afternoon, and then when they got back, she would, of course, be invited, almost expected to stay for supper, where a chair was always set and ready for her to join. And that way, Miss Linda was just always kind of around. She wasn't blood kin, no, but she almost was. She might as well have been. And maybe that's why my family talked about her in such an endearing way. She grew up going to school with my mother's two older sisters, and all three of them would become close friends. And because of that, she came to know and really love my grandmother dearly and treat her as another mother. Miss Linda's love would be extended later to my mother as she got older, and of course my father. And as you might have guessed, that love was a gift to me and my sister, too. She thought a lot of us, and we made sure that feeling was mutual. When my grandmother and grandfather passed and relationship with blood kin started to thin out a bit, as it sometimes does, Miss Linda was still there. Always around to sit and listen, to be present and help if she could. Mostly, she was just allowed. We welcomed her to be part of our lives. We called on Miss Linda to do this in a different sorts of ways. We would give her a ring in the afternoon sometimes to see if she wanted to come over or go out and eat with us. We'd call her to come to the house and just to look at old pictures, and she'd share those stories that family don't tell, but people that know the family tell. She'd tell us those. And we'd always call on Miss Linda when one of us was sick. You see, long before I knew any such things about prayer chains, Miss Linda was a one-person prayer chain. She prayed for people all the time, every day. She would show up at their house with food and other items of comfort, and she would sit with them and be with them until they turned and started to feel better. Or if they never did, she never left. Once, when I was laid up pretty sick in middle school, Miss Linda came over and gave me a prayer cloth that she blessed. I kept that thing for many years. I kept it in my wallet for a long time, and I'm sure my parents still have it somewhere in their house. Miss Linda just did stuff like that, prayed all the time, prayed for everybody. That's what she was known for. And when she stopped in our place, she'd always have a list of the people that she had visited that were sick or in the hospital, and there was always a dozen of those names. She always was seeing somebody. As a kid, I always envisioned Miss Linda that she would just go to the hospital and just wander into rooms and go wherever she felt she needed to be, visiting those that needed prayer or that could use a blessing. I remember one such visit being with there or watching Miss Linda come in. She was coming to visit a family member on my father's side. She came and sat with this man, and she talked with him. And before she left, she asked, as she always did, if she could pray or offer a blessing to him. The man told her that he was okay, that he was really all right, and that she could save her blessing for the next person. It was then that my father's mother, my paternal grandmother, spoke up and said, "Good Lord, Leroy, don't be a fool. Everybody needs prayer. Everybody needs to be blessed." That story always makes me smile and chuckle a bit. The idea of someone not being open to a blessing. Blessings are being counted as blessed. Usually hold a positive view when referenced. Expressions telling us to count our blessings, count them one by one, call us to be thankful for what we have. Even today, on most social media platforms, that idea of hashtag blessed, it tends to trend pretty consistently. In the South, we say stuff too. We say that double-edged expression, bless your heart. We say bless your heart with sweetness when someone is going through a hard time, and we use that same expression with spiciness for a whole different reason, if need be. Most folks can tell the difference in how you deliver that. Sometimes, though, and I don't hear this one as much anymore, but you can be blessed out. Anybody ever got blessed out before? Such as, you know, you hear a story like, so-and-so came over to my house and wasn't happy at all about what happened between me and them, and they just really gave it to me. They blessed me out. That's a blessing steeped in the idea of rebuking. So to be blessed then, as with most things, well, it just seems it depends on the situation. It depends on the context and how it was given and how it was received. In this way, being blessed has a mysterious quality, as it can impact one in all sorts of ways. According to the author of Luke, we see the first encounter here of Jesus and John the Baptist taking place much earlier than when the two greeted one another beside the Jordan River years later. Mary, betrothed spouse to Joseph, and Elizabeth, wife to the priestly Zechariah, were kinfolk. The author tells us that Elizabeth felt her son John, who would be John the Baptizer, move, perhaps even trying then to prepare the way for the Messiah to be, when Mary came in and greeted her. God's Spirit then fell upon Elizabeth, and she exclaimed to Mary that both she and her child were blessed. How? In what way did Elizabeth mean this? How are these blessings to be understood to us today? Maybe overtly favored by God? That's an interpretation. Some scholars suggest that within Jewish culture during that time, that women were only considered blessed solely by their ability to have children or what they carried within them. What was in them was blessed, and so they were blessed as well. That blessing dealt more with proximity than anything. Jesus was blessed, so Mary, the Theotokos, the bearer of God, was by default blessed. Okay? Yet there is some inconsistency here, as we see other examples of women within the biblical text who are called blessed, such as Yael in the book of Judges, that make this claim of being linked to the blessed state of another doubtful. She was called blessed and it was not had anything to do with having a child. No, it would seem that blessed status by Elizabeth was an affirmation of Mary's faith and willingness to trust in the God who had sent an angel to tell her what was going to take place through this complicated blessing. Lutheran pastor Nadia Bolz-Weber offers it this way when thinking about Mary and that conversation, that idea of Mary, did you know? Yes, she knew. Read Luke chapter 1. We have no idea what Mary was like before the angel visited her. But I seriously doubt that she made herself into a girl whom God favored because she took the advice of her youth rabbi and lived the way that she should. Nowhere does it say that the angel Gabriel just waited and waited until he found a girl who had diligently worked on her virtues hard enough that she had made herself worthy to be the God-bearer. The way God seems to favor prostitutes and tax collectors and adulterous kings over the smug and the righteous and powerful, is if that is any indication, then I think it's safe to assume that it is God's nature to look upon young peasant girls with favor, because that's just what God does. Mary got that. Mary got that she couldn't earn this blessing of God, but her response to it was that she just had to receive it. That was what was right for her to do. Sometimes we just have to accept the blessings that are being offered, even when it's complicated one, the one like Mary had. You know, the babe she carries, the fruit of her womb, is blessed as well, is blessed not only by God, but also by her and her faith in accepting what is being asked of her and being blessing of what her role is as a mother and what that means. Jesus was blessed to have Mary as his mother. We shouldn't miss that. If we understand, if we try to comprehend that idea that the triune God is a deity intent on relationship with us and one another, then Jesus was blessed because of Mary, the way he was blessed because, and likewise, how other women would be a blessing to him later. The women who washed and anointed his feet, the woman who gave all she had in front of Jesus at the temple treasury, the woman who took his resurrection story, or the women who took his resurrection story back to the disciples. Jesus was blessed all throughout his life because of women like these, a blessing that worked both ways. And then we come to Mary responding to Elizabeth. Now, before Mary's Magnificat, Elizabeth mentions her being blessed once more, saying, "Blessed is the one who has believed." Elizabeth here appears to make it a central point that Mary's blessedness is tied directly to her being a believer of the news she has received and the acceptance of what was asked of her. The mentioning of her blessed state was probably recorded to run in contrast to that of Elizabeth's husband, Zechariah, who just a few verses ago, before our story today, was made silent and not able to speak until the day his son John was born, because he did not believe the words of the Lord's messenger. Mary is the hero of the story, the believer who acts and responds. And responds she does. The words attributed to her here become one of the greatest hymns to the church. Methodist missionary and theologian Stanley Jones once wrote that Mary's Magnificat was the most revolutionary document the world has ever seen. There's that word, the Magnificat, named after the first word of the line in Latin, the Magnificat Animae Mea Dominum, meaning my soul magnifies the Lord. It starts with Mary. It starts with Mary affirming her faith in God, moving towards what has been described as revolutionary talk about the God movement that is coming, that is already at hand. Author and Duke University doctoral student Caitlin Shee says it this way: "Every discussion when we bring up biblical womanhood should include the fact that in Luke chapter 1, two pregnant women celebrate their new motherhood by passionately discussing the coming overthrow of every earthly empire." Amen, Sister Caitlin. Mary and Elizabeth here are talking revolution for sure. A revolution meaning to bring about change, a moral change that will challenge those who are proud to those who practice immorality and unethical ways toward others. Those who would exploit others and benefit from their misfortune will see their hearts scattered. God's kingdom, the one Jesus will tell others that has come near to them, will be radical in its ways because it means to set the captive free, but also to unseat those who would oppress. It brings them low, but it doesn't leave them low. It then offers them the love and grace extended to all. This revolution will say that the sword doesn't have to be repaid for the sword, that there are other ways, that there is another way. There is a way to challenge the proud by showing them the worst of themselves. I thought a lot about that, and I thought a lot about the things that happened during the civil rights movement. It doesn't seem that long ago that stuff like that was happening, and sometimes it feels like things like that are still happening now. But what really changed a lot of America's views at the time, the views of the United States about what was happening to people and minorities in this country, was that it was on TV. And all of a sudden, it became the problem that we thought these people just couldn't deal with by themselves down south and down in different places up in Chicago. It changed when we watched those people being hurt and bullied and treated as less than human on TV. All of a sudden, it became children who were being hit with fire hoses and women who were being beaten with sticks and dogs sicked on them. That changed the perception. That allowed people to say, wait a second, something is going on here and I need to get involved. Humanity had to look at a flaw in itself and it needed to deal with it. Mary's words describe that here, describe that there needs to be a moral type of revolution involved. And you can see it in Mary's hymn, in Mary's song. Then she moves. Mary moves to describing the powerful being cast down and the lowly, those that are humble, being exalted. Here then, the God movement looks to offer freedom from those oppressive labels. It means to offer an end to that self-serving idea of prestige. It means to challenge systems that would benefit some and not all. It's the same thing that we hear in the message of the prophets. That's the message of Mary. It's the message of Jesus, that the good news has social implications. Bishop Desmond Tutu said that he didn't like the idea of people putting the word in his mouth that he preached a social gospel, stating, I don't preach that. I preach the gospel, period. The gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ is concerned for the whole person. When people were hungry, Jesus didn't say, is that a political or a social issue? He said, I feed you. Because the good news to a hungry person is bread. Others have done this work as well over the years. People like Dorothy Day, Walter Rauschenbusch, and even today, William Barber. These people will tell you there is no such thing as the social gospel, but you can best believe that the gospel is social. Finally, Mary offers that God has filled the bellies and spirits of those who are hungry and sent the rich away empty. Economic change. Economic revolution. Let this be a warning to any economic system that praises the amassing of wealth as the virtue of success, while others starve and do without basic needs. If a nation wishes and desires to be understood as being one built on the principles of Christianity, let there be a spirit troubling those who wish to have too much while their neighbors have too little. Mary, the one called most blessed, gives us her blessing with her song. It's a blessing we see that's complicated and riddled with our calls to participate in different ways. It's a continuous call, where according to the Reverend Leah Davis, Mary is still singing that song today, singing that song through our commitments to do right, to do justice, as we follow her and her liberating son, and through all the artists who know the power of hope, even in the face of systems of empire. Mary extended her blessing to us, blessing our hearts and sometimes blessing us out in order for us to respond to the injustices we see around us. Mary's blessings call us to take part in the world, knowing as she did that all the details aren't there, and it can feel overwhelming and honestly a bit confusing at times. I say let us accept her blessing. Let us start. Let us start by welcoming the news of the coming Lord as she did. It's not a bad place to start. With our souls rejoicing and our lives magnifying God's kingdom, God's call for a revolution that exists through us and among us. Amen. I invite you all now to stand with me in body or spirit and join in the singing. It's on the insert. It's that big page. It's the one I thought I stole earlier from up here, but I stole Peter's paper. It's that one that you all have. Her baby, newly breathing. Please rise and join in us in the singing of this hymn. I remind you all now, we'll have second hour after the service. You can join us for some light snacks and further conversation around this. And remember all the dates that we have, all the announcements, the things that we can take part in this community for love of neighbor. Love to see you all on Christmas Eve and to share that and to show up to one of the services and be present and be part. I'll share this with you as your benediction. We hear the story of Mary, we hear her song, we know that the limitations it feels like to be in places, to be in those relationships where we don't know, where there is all this tension and uncertainty, and yet as people of faith we are called to enter into that and to find those people like Miss Linda's, who are more than family. They are something else. They are that beloved community that Christ has given us, that God has called us into. We get to see this in beautiful ways. We get to see how relationships unfold. We get to see how love is created and love is sustained. And we get to see that on this day, the act of love through a song of a young mother to a child. I've told people before, the first word for God for many children is the word mother. Mary shows us this. She sings it for us today. Let us remember it. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. People of God, go in peace.